Okay, I appreciate the invitation here to present at the NIH Dissemination Conference on Non-Invasive Brain Imaging Modalities. So this slide illustrates one of the fundamental challenges with electrical brain mapping. We're looking at a simultaneously recorded focal seizure. On the left is an invasive EEG recording that's able to resolve at high spatial resolution the location of the seizure. And then on the right, you see a much different scenario when you're recording scalp EEG and measuring a much larger volume due to problems with non-invasive electrical brain mapping and the propagation of the electrical field through the human skull. So there's fundamentally this trade-off between the spatial resolution, invasivity, and the field of view in electrical brain mapping, partly due to the blurring of the electrical fields as they pass through the brain and the skull. And we know this as the solving an ill-defined inverse problem in EEG, which really limits the spatial resolution and accuracy in resolving the origins of these neuronal currents. So our project is dedicated at looking at a new modality, acoustoelectric imaging, which overcomes some of the limitations with other functional brain imaging modalities, in particular EEG. It operates by integrating an ultrasound beam, typically a focused ultrasound beam, that creates an interaction by changing the resistivity of the tissue locally. And we use that in conjunction with Ohm's law to be able to detect a signature signal. It's a radio frequency signal that is near the carrier frequency of the ultrasound that can be detected on a bioelectrode. Now, the advantage of that is that our spatial resolution is limited to the focal volume of our ultrasound beam as it intersects the propagating biological current in the heart or the brain, for example. And the general equation is at the bottom, and you can see that the source equation has been modified to include an ultrasound modulation term, which is related to the ultrasound beam, and the pulse modulation properties. So we have great control in modulating the original EEG signal, which can be recorded simultaneously, a low signal, typically below 10 kilohertz, along with a higher frequency modulated signal together, where the underlying signal is directly proportional to the current densities, the local current density. So four-dimensional current density maps at ultrasound resolution on the millimeter-millisecond scale are possible, and the technology is scalable through the human skull, potentially, which is one of the goals for this project, and it's compatible with standard electrophysiology and pulse echo ultrasound. Now, just to give an example, the motivation for this project was work we've been doing in acoustoelectric cardiac imaging, and I'm going to show just one example. This is in a swine preparation where we place electrodes on the epicardium. And you can see cross-sectional images during the ECG or low-frequency propagation, the cardiac activation wave. But we're looking at the acoustoelectric images recorded simultaneously and the transmural propagation of the currents as they propagate through the wall during the cardiac activation wave. And this allows you to look at the wave propagation and many other properties on this millimeter millisecond scale. So when we look at acoustoelectric brain imaging, we take the same principles, and here's a timing diagram of how that might work. You have some underlying neuronal current, and you can either evoke those signals or they could be naturally occurring without any stimulation. And you can do standard electrophysiology, but then you're bursting the ultrasound beam. The rate of the burst will relate to the temporal resolution in your acoustoelectric image. And on each ultrasound pulse, you're monitoring this interaction signal at times where you have current flowing, brain currents, neuronal currents, and the pressure, the arrival of the acoustic wave, you're going to measure an acoustic electric signal that's shown vertically here in time. In time, we can relate to space based on the depth of propagation, time and depth, speed of sound. And then you can do ultrasound and acoustoelectric detection in potentially real time. Now, as you scan the ultrasound beam around, you can make two-dimensional, three-dimensional, and volume over time images using those same principles that I showed on the previous slide. Now, the TABI project, Transcranial Acoustoelectric Brain Imaging, our goal is to really demonstrate for the first time a modality that can look at non-invasive human a brain imaging of neuronal currents at the millimeter and millisecond scales. So that's kind of our real goal for this NIH-funded project. So we really want to push the limit of 4D mapping of neuronal currents, we will be enhancing the instrumentation and overcoming challenges with existing infrastructure, equipment, and including the software algorithms, looking to optimize and validate tABI in human head models and in vivo swine, and then to be able to assess this for human brain imaging through the skull. So really the major challenge that we have currently would be to be able to detect very weak signals through the skull. And this is kind of a baseline metric. We recently published a study with our human head model and skull where we were able to get roughly 350 microamp detection. That's ultrasound, transcranial ultrasound delivery, with electrodes placed on top of the skull, and we're comparing when the electrodes are on the brain versus skull. You can see in this case a drop of about 3 or 4 dB. So it just gives us a rough idea of where we are with existing instrumentation. So this project will be pushing the envelope. It includes four aims. The last two aims are really about translation of the technology and the equipment imaging system, the upgraded system, to humans. And I'll be going through a little more detail just each of these specific aims. So before I get to that, I want to kind of show what my team looks like. We've got a technical team, a brain science team, what I call it, and a clinical team, neuroradiologists and neurosurgeons, psychiatrists. We have a diverse group, and together with the University of Washington, Matt O'Donnell's PI subcontract, to develop some new algorithms that we think can really push the limits of our imaging system. So this is what the project timeline looks like. It's a 5-year project. We don't really get into human studies. The plan wouldn't be to probably year 3. The first 2 years are really about building the next generation system and calibration and testing, so we know that we not only have the sensitivity and can do this, but we can also do this safely in humans and have worked out the key parameters that will be necessary to bring this technology to humans. So this first aim is really about this next generation system. We're working on the electronics, the RF sensing, to bring in multi-electrode capability to detect the acoustoelectric signal, new ultrasound equipment and arrays devoted towards transcranial ultrasound through the human skull, and integrating a neuronavigation system, which we think is very important for being able to monitor and deliver safely ultrasound to the targeted region in the brain and to be able to guide things in real time so we have a frame of reference. And just roughly, the neuronavigation system will be able to incorporate a head modeling, MRI, the sensors. And we're also working on a relatively new sequence, ultra-short UTE, ultra-short T2 sequence on MRI, to be able to segment the skull, to be able to optimally model the ultrasound and the delivery to the brain. As many of us here know, the scope of this project is really ultimately for healthy volunteers. So whereas CT might be normally used to segment the skull, we don't see that as a viable option for this RFA, the mission of this project. So we want to be able to develop MR techniques, which we think can do a fairly good job at looking at the skull. Aim 2 is all about optimizing, calibrating, and validating the next generation system that we've developed. We've got head models, which I've shown earlier. We're working with University of Washington in particular on advanced signal processing. And we have acoustoelectric models that we have developed that we're implementing to look at a lot of these parameters, including the effects of the skull and lead fields for the acoustoelectrics. And then, of course, validation in animal models. So what does the animal model look like? Well, really the goal of our pig model that we've developed is to establish an electrophysiologic ground truth for comparing with the TABI measurements. And here you're seeing our swine model. This is a kind of a traditional model where we can do snout stimulation and activate different regions of the somatosensory cortex in this case. This is what some of our instrumentation looks like. our low frequency recording and stimulation for activating the snout, our mobile cart current system, first generation system for in vivo TABI with all the electronics and ultrasound hardware, and then our interface with the brain and the coupling. This is an open brain preparation, although we have plans to integrate skull to look at skull effects, and we have done that to some extent. But really the primary goal of this model is to demonstrate the capabilities of of the acoustoelectric brain imaging and then push the limits of the detection, as I described earlier. So this is really the paradigm, one of the paradigms, the behavioral paradigm, where we can selectively activate different regions of the somatosensory cortex. We have a second paradigm where we can chemically induce seizures with bioequivalent injections. And here you're looking at seizures that can last 10 to 15 minutes, transient seizures. And we think both of these paradigms are excellent for the swine model in particular, and with the ultimate goal of validating and optimizing this new modality. Now, we can integrate, as I mentioned before, our acoustoelectric brain imaging system into those paradigms. This is a simplified version of what that looks like. And here's an example of the kind of images that we have seen. The experiments, because we are measuring a small signal, and it depends on the noise level, and there's a lot of different factors. So there is some sort of there is quite a bit of variability when we perform these experiments. So that's one of the things we're addressing in our second generation system. But you can get a good idea. On the left, you're looking at what we call an M-mode image, which is really depth over time, millisecond time axis. That's the physiologic time axis where we can see the evoked potential, low frequency signal on the top. But then we see at a very particular depth over time activation on the surface of the cortex of the pig. And in each vertical row is a profile in depth of that activation. Now, of course, we get sign and amplitude information with the acoustoelectrics, which tells you something about the direction of the current as well as the amplitude. And then on the right, you can see at different times during the low frequency signal activation at particular regions and depths. And this is now a cross-section looking at a rostral caudal axis. Of course, we can scan the beam in two dimensions and get volumetric images as well, one of the goals with ultimately a four-dimensional modality. So here are some of the key milestones and metrics. We've seen month 24 as being critical because by that time, we would have built the second generation system, done initial calibrations, and determined whether we've got these minimum, what we call minimum requirements of moving forward in translating the technology to humans. Now, we'd like to be on the right, the better the detection here. Sensitivity is the key in signal to noise. The better the sensitivity, the weaker neural currents we'll be able to detect and to make this a viable modality, especially through either thin or thick human skull. So once we get to that point by year three, our first behavioral model will be working with extraoperative epilepsy patients who are implanted with a grid or depth electrodes. So we have electrodes local to the brain, so we would be delivering ultrasound through the skull and using those local electrodes to detect not only EEG or electrophysiologic signals, but also the acoustoelectric signal. We'll be integrating navigation and a lot of the tools that we've developed during the first 2 years to be able to really show, hey, we can put this together and measure a signal in a human and be able to map a relevant, whether those are evoked signals, or the model it will be to stimulate the median nerve, to be able to control that activation, to generate large dipoles in the human brain. But ultimately, to continue to validate and optimize so we can move to the fourth aim, which is really looking at healthy volunteers where everything is non-invasive. Both the electrodes, whether those are EEG or other types, and ultrasound are delivered through the skull. It's basically a no-go task where we're doing what we call vibrotactile stimulation at different regions and being selectively activating different regions of the cortex and human brain. And we can control that a little bit analogous to what we were doing with the snout stimulation in the pig. But this will be the real test to determine whether such a modality can be brought into fruition, especially for healthy volunteers, where we see tremendous potential millimeter millisecond scales, non-invasively, potentially four-dimensional, where we can then use this to diagnose, stage, monitor, guide treatment of a variety of diseases. Could be neurologic, psychiatric, behavioral. Obviously, we're looking at epilepsy as one of the models, but we're looking at multiple other possible diseases where and even normal brain function, where this modality could dramatically improve our understanding of these the physiologic processes that might be involved, not only for the development of the diseases, but also for the recovery. And I want to note that this is potentially a really safe and mobile technology. And I think that's another reason why it's attractive. It's a moonshot in some ways, but we think it's possible. So this is really the larger team. I'm listing the academic collaborators, the pictures, most of the pictures I showed in the previous slide. We've got industrial collaborators. I want to just add that I have my own startup company, Electrosonics, which is really commercializing the cardiac side of the acoustoelectric imaging technology. So I obviously have a financial interest on that side. We have a number of patents in the federal funding. And for that, I'm happy to take questions. Thank you.